surprised you are doing quite well. So possibly we can.
See, I
don't.
Yeah.
Okay, maybe. It's 10:45 on the higher.
Oh, okay.
So, on behalf of Nal Sir, I welcome Mr. Swapan Das Gupta. So, obviously, setting up talks towards the end of the semester is always a hazard, but at least some of you have shown up, so that's a redeeming fact for us. So, Mr. Das Gupta will be speaking about, or the title that we've suggested was Conservatism and the Indian Right. And obviously, many of you know him from his television avatar. He appears on many primetime news channels as a panelist. He speaks at campuses from time to time, and has had a distinguished career as a journalist, and is now working independently. So I don't think he needs a specific sort of grand introduction. We'll move straight to the talk. The plan is that perhaps Mr. Das Gupta will speak for about 40 to 50 minutes, and then we'll keep about 20 odd minutes for the question and answer session, right? So I think on the clock we are around 10:40 at the moment, so possibly we'll go up to 11:45 or so, right? So can we start then? Or are we expecting more people to show up? Okay, right.
Thank you, Siddharth. I'm truly grateful to Nal Sir for organizing this, despite your constraints of... Is this echoing or... Can you hear me perfectly? Well, I do realize that it's the end of term and you have your pressure of your freedom from the campus, the expectation of that. So despite that, I'm grateful you've turned up to hear this. A slightly abstruse subject, and I'm saying it's abstruse partly because despite whatever the introduction has given me of being a journalist, my real identity and my passion and my entry into this subject, or into this rather the whole sphere of Indian politics, was more by the nature of as a refugee from academia. I am, which the introductions don't mention, something which I would call a lapsed historian, because I did spend the first, till the age of 30, that's all I did, was study history, and I did a bit too much of it and abandoned it for the more contemporary. So this talk will primarily concentrate between the interface between the past and the present. And it will not be so much about contemporary nitty-gritty politics, not the type which make headlines, but it will be on some of the assumptions, some of the ideas which have shaped contemporary politics and certain facets of the right. Now, where do I start? You know, there used to be a suggestion, at least 30, 40, or maybe even two decades ago, that the right in India is a bit of a non-starter. It was said that the right in democracies, particularly in countries which have a large section of people below the poverty line, would never get traction. And this was an impression which was bolstered by the contemporary fashion of that time, which said that the prevailing ideology is one of socialism. Now, if we go back to 2014, the election results of 2014, you will find that all over the world, and not least amongst the Indian punditry, there was an expression of surprise, consternation, and in some cases, absolute horror as to what exactly has happened. This was not programmed in our minds that such an outcome should ever happen in India. And the reason for that is exactly the same. Here was a movement, here was a strain of thought which was supposed to have lacked all intellectual pedigree. It was said to have had no intellectual inheritance. A very dear friend of mine, Ramchandra Guha, whose popular books on history some of you may have read, has often been fond of saying that where are the right intellectuals? They don't exist. It's a body of thought, it's a body of opinion which lacks any thought. And this is a view which has also come around some places, even from Europe, when conservative parties have often been called the stupid party. And it's also an impression that some of the conservatives, ironically, have promoted of themselves. That, oh yes, we are the stupid party. Now, I know it's bad form sometimes to read history backwards, but if you were to say that what an outcome of 2014 happened, obviously there must have been strands of thinking which predated that, but which, for various reasons, people chose either to ignore or to underplay or pretend it didn't happen. Now, before we get into the specifics of the Indian situation, let me just delve a little bit on what we mean by the term conservative and why it is, you see, there is a problem of conservatives, because sometimes it has been lumped with the larger category called right. Now, right is a very omnibus term. It can cover anything. It can cover a fascist, it can cover a constitutional conservative, it can cover someone who's wedded to the free market, and it can cover almost, I mean, the range of what constitutes the right is really quite infinite, and it's very nebulous and difficult to define. And this is further complicated by certain judgmental use of positing progressive versus reactionary. So, who is progressive and by whose standards, and who is reactionary by whose standards? These are complicated questions. So I always have preferred the term conservative as a more accurate description. Now, modern conservatism, at least as far as in democratic world is concerned, is something which really dates back to the reactions to the French Revolution in 1789. It was really the people who were opposed to that who constituted the body of thought which later came to be called conservatism. And in that, the name of Edmund Burke is obviously paramount. Burke, for the want of anything else we can call, is probably considered the father of modern conservatism. And most of the attitudes and the assumptions which govern conservatism can be located to that. A very important facet of conservatism is the fact that it is not universal. Unlike socialists, you can have a socialist international of various people having, you know, common facets. It's very difficult to talk about a conservative international, because conservatism, by its very definition and its evolution, has always been national. Disraeli once pointed out that the Conservative Party, and he was talking about his own party, Conservative Party in Britain, is either national or it is nothing. And I think therefore it's very important to realize that when you're studying the feature of conservatism, while you can talk about certain generalizations, you have to always boil down to what are the specific national features. There is something called Japanese conservatism, there is something specific about German conservatism, or even about French and British. So likewise, always take the national specificities into mind. Now, another feature of conservatism is the general disinclination of conservatisms to reduce their body of thought to theoretical constructs or dogma. There is a complete abhorrence of abstraction among conservatives. And this is one facet which a lot of people might find quite interesting, that the belief that human nature is too frail and too nebulous to be codified into one set of predetermined experiences. That is a very, very important fact. So there is that innate respect for human frailty. That, another, is an important one. Then there is the preference for community wisdom, what I loosely call community wisdom, over individual choices. That's the, probably in my mind, that forms the sharpest distinction between what conservatives believe and what liberals believe. Not necessarily what Marxists believe. You see, and I just want a small passage from Burke. And he wrote that the individual is foolish, but the species is wise. Prejudices and prescriptions are the instruments which the wisdom of the species employ to safeguard man against his own passions and appetites. Now here, if you notice, the word prejudice is not being used in the common pejorative sense in which we are using. Here, prejudice is being an innate, instinctive view. How do people respond instinctively? And how they respond instinctively is guided by a lot of factors, not necessarily what they've learned in a classroom. It's guided by their circumstances, their inheritance, their geographies, their religions, all sorts of features. So that is, you know, therefore the conservatives always try to uphold what another philosopher, Roger Scruton, one of the most articulate, if somewhat abstruse, philosophers of conservatism have said, is called common decencies. Now, if you say, why common decencies? It is what people instinctively react. And what is right and what is good is probably a part of their set, it's part of their DNA. Till circumstances dictate it should be otherwise. It flows from there that there is in conservatism a paramount importance which is attached to the sacred in maintaining national life. Because in most civilizations, you'll find that there has been a great importance attached to the sacred in determining what you are, your condition, etc. And this is not something which is uniquely Indian in any way. In fact, in India, there are far greater complexities to this. But in monotheistic religions, particularly, this is very much. And in Christendom, in Europe, there is that feature about the maintenance of the sacred, of how state power and sacredness almost go hand in hand. A useful reminder to those who sort of are quite have opinions on this entire Bharat Mata controversy, that it has a very interesting pedigree of one thing. You see, there is also the belief among conservatives that the authority of the state must be circumscribed by the will of society. In other words, the great crusader, the great do-gooder, whether it's in the form of a certain body of opinion or an individual, cannot overturn everything, the world upside down, or must not turn the world upside down. That you must adhere to what has been there before and what will follow after. Burke put it very nicely. He said, society is basically a contract between the living, the dead, and the unborn. So the linkages which straddle that is very much. Hence the basic term conservatives, to try and conserve, the cautiousness about change, to not give in to impulse, to not always have a knee-jerk reaction, and, if I might say so, not leave the entire process of change to some few judges. Might be an important point to people who delve in the law. The change has to be a far more complex and a more measured thing. And lastly, I would say that what is important about conservatism is that it sees itself as the embodiment of national identity. So for a conservative, it doesn't do to merely be a patriot. You have to be a nationalist simultaneously. Therefore, your adherence to national identity is far more profound than your adherence, your commitment to what is increasingly being called constitutional patriotism, a term which emanated from Germany in the thing. Habermas was a great advocate of that. And increasingly I'm finding in some of the writings that how the constitutional patriotism is the be-all and end-all of your national identity. I'll come to that issue later. But all I can say is that can the Constitution epitomize the entire gamut of experience? Can that be codified? I mean, take a case of France. I just want to give, it's a very random, perhaps a very extreme case. Now the French, in the course of the past 100 years or so, have gone through about 4 or 5 republics. What does constitutional patriotism mean in the case of France? I mean, they've gone through as many republics as perhaps Zaza Gabor went through husbands. Now, does that mean that the French lack any form of national identity because their sense of constitutional patriotism is so nebulous? But there is a profound French national identity. It's expressed through culture, it's expressed through its music, its art, even its cuisine. These are facets of the French national identity, their language, their literature, which is all above and beyond that of the Constitution. And I wanted to use that because this is probably the starkest example I can use, but it just suggests that it's an oversimplification to reduce everything. Now, in the case of India, there are two basic problems when we talk about Indian conservatism. The first is the fact that in all the cases where conservatism was codified, with Burke being the main architect, all of them had a normal evolutionary process of a transition from absolutism to democracy, and within that democracy, you tried to shape it. The British, for instance, in all the, I don't know if you all study English common law, but in that, you'll find constant invocation to something called the ancient constitution. Now, the ancient constitution is the bedrock of what might be called there. Now, in India, we have a problem. Partly because in India, we lost national sovereignty. Now, some people say we lost national sovereignty in 1757. Some people would say, no, we lost sovereignty much earlier. That's an interesting historical debate. But the important point is that because you didn't have national sovereignty, your articulation of conservatism was not devoted so much to the building up of national political institutions, but it focused much more on things like culture, faith, identity, national pride. These were the issues which defined Indian conservatism, as opposed to Western American, British conservatism. Just, you know, things like rule of law, ancient constitution, the Federalist Papers. These are the terms you come across in the study in the Americas and the Anglophone world. The second big problem you find in understanding conservatism in India is that there is no Indian equivalent of the word conservatism. And this is not a problem specific to conservatism. Chris Bailey, a very distinguished professor of history in Cambridge who died last year, wrote this fascinating book on the history of Indian liberalism and thought. And there he also made that confession that I can't find any Indian equivalent of what is liberalism. Likewise, I have asked various people, and all of them suggested that the term conservatism could actually mean in Indian languages something in opposition to, not something in itself. So you can be anti-progressive, Pragatishil Virodhi or something. I mean, some of them someone gave me the word Rudhivadi. Someone said as the opposite of liberal, Anudarpanthi. Now, none of these are words in common usage. They have not filtered down to the normal political vocabulary. These are therefore very, very recent injections into the language of politics and of the language of thought in India. Then there is this peculiar notion that while in terms of Indian political thought, there's been a lot of very interesting and profound studies which have been done on how certain Western liberal thinkers, Western thinkers, Bentham, Mill, Marx, etc., have influenced various individuals. But there's been very little by the way of to what extent have Indian thinkers been influenced by what are called traditional knowledge systems. This is absolutely new study. And the reasons for this we can discuss, and it's got to do with this entire big thing about Sanskrit and Indology and where it stands, etc., and what are the focuses. That's an interesting but a separate debate altogether. Therefore, because of this, it has often been felt that Indian conservatism and liberalism were actually joined at the hip from birth, that there was no clear-cut distinction. I'll give you one classic example. Take the case in the mid-19th century, there was this huge battle over sati, the abolition of sati, which was effected sometime in the 1830s. Now, if you look at the debate on sati, you'll find something very interesting. And this ties in very well to the debates which are going on about the entry of women in the Shani temples and other, the Sabarimala, etc. Most of the people who championed the abolition of sati drew their arguments essentially from the Shastras. They quoted chapter and verse of the Shastra saying this is a deviation, this is an aberration, etc. Those who opposed it didn't necessarily want that sati should be made obligatory and compulsory. What they wanted was they too quoted from the Shastras. And they added one more thing, which was very interesting. They said, what is the right of an alien Christian government to interfere in the laws of this country? And this was a debate again during the Age of Consent Bill in the 1890s, which happened between Gokhale and Tilak. Gokhale, being the great progressive, said yes, the age of consent must be raised. And I think there was a compelling case for it. And the others said, well, you can raise it, but let's not get the British government to legislate on it. So what is the difference between, here we have this classic confusion of categories as to who was the liberal and who was the conservatism, and because they both took their inspiration from the same sources, with one saying, adding in the additional issue of national sovereignty. You lack national sovereignty, therefore don't get it in. I was just pointing this out, and it's also important to note that, for instance, in the Sati debate, there was this gentleman called Radhakantu Dev. He was the main organizer of the anti-legislation movement. Now, the important thing about Radhakantu Dev is that while he opposed Ram Mohan Roy, he was actually one of the biggest champions of women's education in Bengal. So the sheer range of possibilities which come about by trying to be too simplistic and saying this one is progressive, this one is reactionary, I think The point really is that colonialism actually had something what might loosely be called a neurotic effect on Indian. On one hand, there was a great deal of appreciation of British rule, and this cannot be denied. I mean, we might rewrite history many times over, etc., but it cannot be that till about the Jallianwala Bagh massacre, the legitimacy of British rule was never seriously questioned. It may have been questioned in 1857 by people who were still attached to what might be called the Anshiyan regime, which means they looked upon the Mughals as the true inheritors of the sovereignty. But other than that, at least in the three presidencies, it was never contested seriously. At the same time, there was this huge appreciation, the desire to imbibe as much as Western civilization as possible. You know, the if you read some of the older Bengali poets, you'll find the gushing appreciation of British rule and everything that was English there. Curiously, that coexisted with a profound sense of thinking, but what have we done wrong that we are today in this state? What were the mistakes? So what are the shortcomings of Indian society that enabled the British, a few handful of British, to actually take over? So all these various things are coexisting at the same time. Praise of British rule, concern for what did we do wrong. And that in itself led to various interesting conclusions. Bankim Chandra Chatterjee, now I use Bankim Chandra Chatterjee because again he's a popular figure, Vande Mataram, the author of Vande Mataram, the iconic thing. He has a very interesting take, for instance. In Anandamart, he more or less explicitly says that British rule is much better than anything else. Secondly, he goes on to berate in different writings the gluttony, what he calls, of Hindus who think that progress means eating beef. And he berates Hinduism for being too otherworldly. So the problem with Hinduism, we think all living beings are the same, etc. As a result, we've reduced ourselves to atomized individuals and lack any sense of corporate citizenship. So this lack of corporate citizenship became the buzzword of more or less all of them at that time. Later in the Punjab, you find Lala Lajpat Rai and many of the Arya Samajis talking the same thing. You find in Gandhi, in Hind Swaraj, one of his earliest writings, a great deal in saying, I don't blame the British for taking over India, we have to look at ourselves. So it's this concern of how do we look at ourselves and what are the indigenous institutions we should be looking at, which to my mind forms the bedrock of Indian conservatism. It's that has its origin in that. The examination of what went wrong in India. And how can we be Indians again? That was the principal concern at that time. And this debate went through various phases, etc. I think it's only in the 1920s with Savarkar where you find that this takes on a slightly different complexion. Those who say that Bharat Mata is equal to a certain regressive thing are actually wrong, because that's the idea of an Indian sacredness, the India being sacred, it actually predates that. It's got a long history. You'll find that in the early writings of Aurobindo. You will find it. So it's very much there. What I thought, where Savarkar was a little different, was that he says that Hindus are those who believe that India is not only their Pitribhumi, you could use, at some points he uses Matribhumi as well. That's not a very big deal. But also the Punya Bhumi. Means it's not only your motherland, but it's also your sacred land. That, and in that sense, those who do not believe India is their sacred land are by definition not citizens of this country. Now that's where the departure really starts. That citizenship becomes really a question of faith, of what your beliefs are. You know, Gandhi, in his own way, tried to tackle this issue. He tried to tackle it by saying, look, religion is very important. It's central to India's existence. But he tried to combine it with a sort of a loose something called a multi-faith patriotism. I mean, you sing your Raghupati Raghava, you do your thing, you recite. It's the classic, you know, multi-faith things which happen. Everybody comes and reads their own little thing, and you know, that's, everyone's happy after that. So that was Gandhi's method, and it could have worked had the Khilafat movement actually led to a far more meaningful unity of both the communities in India. Probably could have worked. But the fallout of the Khilafat movement after 1922 was devastating. Far from bringing the Hindu and Muslim communities together, it led to a very sharp schism, some of which were political, some of which was other, civilized. You know, one preys on the other. Let's not go into what was responsible. So the idea of a unified project which deviates from Savarkar's Hindu-centric thing was in a sense destroyed at that particular point. So willy-nilly, even though nobody wanted to actually talk about Savarkar's thing, that the currents which emanated from there actually became a part of the whole national movement. People have often asked, why is it that there was no explicitly Hindu mobilization during the nationalist movement? The reason for it is very simple, because the Hindu mobilization for the during the nationalist movement after the was within the Congress. All the local studies which are there shows that it's not Nehruvian ideas which prevailed in the Congress. That might have prevailed at the right at the apex level, but at the grassroots it was a far more Bharat Mata, using Diwali, the more use of how the evil British will be. So the imagery was definitely. And to go back to immediately after post-independence, anti-conversion legislation, anti-cow slaughter legislation, these were not passed by the BJP or the Janasangh as it was called. They were nowhere in government. They were not even a dot on the legislative bench. They were all part of the Central Congress agenda. Because the Congress realized at that time, and this was certainly apart from Nehru, most of the others, whether it was Dr. Rajendra Prasad, whether it was Sardar Patel, Rajaji, etc., realized that you cannot run India without a secularism which didn't have a Hindu ethos as well. So it was not that they were against secularism in the classic sense of the term. It's not that they wanted India to be a Hindu denominational state, but that they felt that to have a viable democratic culture, you needed to accommodate what loosely today's term has been called a majority. The impulses had to be accommodated. So there has been a lot of revisionism subsequently about what has happened, of what is the prehistory of India, of how when we talk about what the constitution makers wanted, and this is the founding fathers have said, there's a lot of stuff which resonates today. You must realize that, like most things in India, for something that is true, the opposite is equally true. That it's never a case of black and white. It's always a lot of complexities which go in there. Where the conservatives failed was in one major respect, that A, being in the Congress, they were basically sidelined after the split of 1969. If today someone has to ask, what is the reason why the BJP has grown? I would say, look at it, if you look at it in contemporary political terms, start from 1969, Because the Congress, from being the broad church, became, some would say, a dynastic institution, some would say an overtly left-wing institution. You can take your pick in which one you want to choose. But that broad church character of the Congress was lost in 1969. But at the same time, the oppositional forces didn't have the necessary electoral muscle. Because they were going into, you see, what was the history of the Jansang or even those prior to 1990? They were talking about Hindi agitation in Uttar Pradesh, some anti-cow slaughter, something, and some sadhus going in the berserk somewhere, going berserk somewhere or the other. Fringe issues. That never really affected the mainstream. The turning point came, and this is where I would say that here again, conservatism has a various facets. Conservatism is not necessarily constitutionalism or the state parliamentary politics. Conservatism also takes into account something called grievances. There is a sense of loss which must be felt for conservatism too. And that sense of loss is what really took over, and that was the issue on which the BJP took off in the late 80s on the Ram movement. That, to my mind, is very important because it was a mass engagement. From being a party of, you know, small traders in mandi towns, etc., they became a mass movement. The incorporation of the backward caste in particular. Huge. I mean, today the BJP, the social character of the BJP is a backward caste party with some layers of Brahmins on the top. Then what happened was the BJP had always been seen to be a very Sanskritic party. I'm using that in a very loose term. The party of the big tradition. The Ram Janmabhoomi movement allowed it to connect the little tradition, because the Ram worship in the towns of Uttar Pradesh, Karnataka, etc., are really all about small local village temples, local faiths. Most of the songs and things which were produced during that movement were all in sort of rather ribald Bhojpuri songs, which were there talking about, you know, the glory of Ram. All of them had their little social connections. So the connection of the little tradition with the big tradition was a very, very important facet of that. So the break, as you can see, you have a tradition which starts off somewhere, moves in separate move, and then moves on to ultimately a popular populist category using the sense of loss. No, I can go on at this about this, but and I think the time is more or less right to it. Therefore, what I've tried to do is not really engage in contemporary politics, but give you a sense of the historical lineage and the patterns of growth in which allowed a certain form of ideology to take place. Now, the challenges before the conservatives is, to what extent do they accommodate economics into this? Now, if you notice, when my definition of conservatism, I did not mention free markets anywhere as a defining facet of conservatism. That's partly because a lot of people and a lot of profound thinkers believe that the relationship between the state and the citizen cannot be transactional. The state is the big parent, and you cannot have a transactional relationship. That obviously means that you must let society flow. That could form the genesis of conservative thought, which has led to the saying that the state must not have too intrusive a role. Likewise, when they say that social engineering or even judicial engineering must not play a role in social change, that too could be the genesis of it. Now the question arises, is to what extent does conservatism in India take on the Rajaji route, Rajagopalachari, who is one of the probably the only politician in India who is professedly a conservative. He used the term in the 50s, but at the same time, who combined his love for free markets with a hostility to the Soviet Union and believed that the greatest evil which the Nehruvian regime had inflicted on India was that it had taken the religious impulse out of society. So you can see in Rajaji a very curious blend of these various strands which we, but Rajaji is rarely mentioned except by some odd individuals today. So that, Tisha, where do we go with economics? Finally, how does conservatism come to a satisfactory theoretical resolution, at least in the mental, about differing religions? This has been one of the biggest failures of conservatism in India. The failure to actually, while it has certainly upheld the Hindu ethos, it has protected it, given it a new shape in some cases, it has never directly confronted, intellectually I mean, as to what do you do with other forms of beliefs and other forms of whose civilizational inspirations are a little different. That remains one of the biggest outstanding questions and is a cause of a lot of the contemporary political tensions which happen. So at least these are some of the outstanding questions which are there. And finally, to what extent should a conservative also be a radical? Now, this is not a new question. Is Margaret Thatcher a conservative or a radical? Some people would say Margaret Thatcher is a radical. Was Ronald Reagan a radical or a conservative? So you see, the label is not the thing. Today, for instance, in the government, you have both impulses working. You have someone like my friend Arun Jaitley, who I would consider an absolutely moderate conservative in the old-fashioned Westminster sense of the term. But then how do you call the Mahant of Gorakhnath Temple, who is also an MP? Do you call him a radical? In some ways, he is a radical, because he's got some of his solutions are completely zany, if not... But there are radical impulses of people who say constitution must be, Sanskrit must be made the national language. Extreme case. There are others who have equally, you know, sort of similar cultural features which they want to highlight. Now, the trying to balance all of them as to what is the defining impulse of conservatism, or should it have a defining impulse? These are some of the unattended intellectual projects which I feel are important. Alas, they don't form the feature of media discourse, which is a bit more located in sloganeering. But at least I just wanted to give you all some food for thought, that when you view politics, try and view politics beyond the breaking news. Just look at some of the other intellectual inheritance which has actually shaped what we are today. Thank you very much.
Okay, so I think traditionally the right-wing view finds poor representation in Indian universities, and in fact the conversation that we were having privately was that the way in which we teach our undergraduate courses on history and politics and sociology often also caricature the idea of conservatism to some extent. So it's always important for us to also hear the counter view, right? But just before we take questions, so I think Mr. Dasgupta's talk has made a very important point that many of us struggle to convey to you in the classroom, that when we learn about the conservative and liberal distinction in the history of Western political philosophy, sometimes transplanting it automatically to the Indian context is hard, right? So even though we start our courses by talking about the presumptions of Western political liberalism, things like suspicion of concentration of power, separation between religion and state, a sort of preference for free markets, remember we are lumping together several levels of claims about political and economic liberalism, right? So obviously to understand conservatism as a sharp opposite of all these strands is also a mistake. Right? So you can't simply say that because conceptually we've heard the liberal and conservative divide in social media discourse or the 9 PM news, that can't be a lens for examining issues today or even to understand the past. So I think that was an important clarification which came through very clearly in Mr. Dasgupta's talk. So before we open up, I'll just maybe ask one question and maybe use my bully pulpit to ask one question. That traditionally when we engage with the Indian constitution even in our curriculum here, and I'm not talking about just this school, I also went to a similar school earlier, one of the central accounts of Indian constitutionalism is that the partition riots had an immediate impact, or in a sense had an immediate bearing on the minds of the framers, because the process was happening in Delhi and you had this large influx of refugees and the images of violence which were certainly affecting them. So not only is there an immediate sort of response to the partition in terms of, let's say, legislation to restore abducted women or even the question of how to frame emergency powers, but there's also a long shadow on the very imagination of law. And I think there are some examples which you were mentioning in your talk. So for example, the entire controversy on conversion or even the persistence of suspicion about invocations of religion in public life. And there's one account, or there's one sort of set of commentators on the Indian constitution who would say that inherent suspicion of religious expression comes from that immediate aftermath of the partition. So this is one sort of theory that we often discuss in our framework. Now, I think conflating it with the broader idea of Nehruvian socialism could also be a mistake. So for instance, the idea here is, again, it's coming more from a critical perspective, that sometimes the immediate memory of violent acts is reflected in how you would respond to it in the short run. But institutional violence can also have long-term consequences on the very imagination of law in the long run. So for those who would disagree with you, right, they would say, look, but this imagination of a nationalism which is grounded in culture, grounded in the sort of, you were trying to convey it in a far more clear form, the idea that you could be Hindu and also secular, right, those who disagree with you would say, but look, the framing of the constitution has already committed us to a position where the state must necessarily discourage the expression of religion in public life. I mean, that would be the sort of opposing view which I'm sure you've had to navigate.
Yeah, well, a few points. Firstly, I don't know how many of you have actually seen the original sort of facsimile copy of the original document of the Constitution. It's quite fascinating. In the preamble, which of course does not have secularism and socialism, but we all know that was a later edition. It's the paintings on the side. It's the paintings on the site are really literally basically Hindu motifs. So never was in the minds of the constitution makers any conflict between India as a country which is predominantly, and I would say use the word loosely, Hindu, but not exclusively so, ever absent from their minds. Neither were they defensive about it. It was part of ordinary being. It's part of what I call the instinctive responses of people. The principal issue of the Constitution, to my mind as I read it, is that the unity of India had to be safeguarded. And at that time, till about the mid-50s, for example, there were people who were talking about the imminent disintegration of India. Today, we don't talk about it. But the idea that India as we know it, whether we see it as a country, whether we see it as a sacred land, or whether we see it as a market, is somehow going to abruptly, you know, some unstuck is not there. But it was a very much a So therefore, a lot of the laws, except for the over-centralization. And over-centralization, we can talk in various ways. We can talk about over-centralization as a response to these challenges. We can talk about over-centralization in the way the Muslim League actually looked at it. That the impulses of the Congress was principally centralist, and they were suspicious of federalism. And they couldn't do it. So, and they have, therefore, this was one of the reasons why Jinnah felt that it could never be enough. Well, that's a different
there's a fascinating sort of discussion from the other side in Akhil Bilgrami's recent book. So I suppose if we ever get the chance of getting both of you together, then maybe that might be a future event we can plan. So we're open for questions and comments. I know that year one students are taking their courses on history and political science. So while not sounding like an imposition, we would expect some informed engagement from you as well, right? So it doesn't just have to be a question, it could also be a comment on what you felt about the various lines of argument which Mr. Dasgupta has touched upon. Yeah. Okay, Harshit, yeah.
I'll
just put the mic on.
Good morning. So while I do realize that much of your speech was focused on tracing the history and lineage of conservative ideology and movement, but focusing the question on a contemporary sense, in a modern Indian democracy, do you think that the progressive form of conservatism and not the reactionary, as you pointed out, can accommodate the dominant interest of reverence for the sacred cow or aggressively pushing for celebrating national symbols like Bharat Mata? And if yes, how?
Yeah, it's a... You see, the point about the cow is, you know, this is a very sensitive issue. Not so much cow as beef. I mean, I'll make that distinction. I mean, the cow is treated very casually in India. But beef arouses passions which are quite sensitive. I mean, try traveling in a Air India international flight, or be with some Indian passengers in an economy class of an international flight. The first thing is beef. So it is very, very, it is a very, very sensitive thing. So how do you handle this? Do you handle, the question really comes to how do you handle this? And, you know, there are various, you know, means which have been suggested about, you know, some people say, forget the cow, look at the buffalo. So in India, we have the curious thing of actually buffalo, when we say beef, actually 9 out of 10 times you're actually referring to buffalo meat.
Especially in Hyderabad.
Exactly. Now,
Kalyani biryani.
So, but it is a big question, and any mention of it does arouse passions, and that's real. So you have a choice, either you reinvent Indian people, their minds, which a lot of progressives sometimes want to do, or you accept that and try to find some non-confrontational ways of getting this done. It's not an easy question to answer, and as far as the flag is concerned, as far as this, you know, flag waving is a part of, go to a cricket match. You know, it doesn't, there is a certain set of cosmopolitan values which would say that deny your inheritance. You're proud to wear a stars and stripes as a t-shirt, but you want to do the same with the tricolor. Now, not realizing that in India, the mental association with the flag is a little different. You know, the cultural values are not the same. So that is something, I feel that in this case, sometimes the modern cosmopolitans lose sight of that in their haste to be global. And by global, inevitably, often it means American.
Okay, Anil, just use the mic there.
Where do you draw the line?
Yeah. Firstly, when we talk about conservative impulses, you know, the most important, why do conservative ideas gain currency in a particular context? If everything is as it should be, we are proceeding famously with cautious levels of change, there is no need for a conservative movement. Because your society is reflecting that. So therefore I said, always, inevitably, and this is one of the ironies of it, the conservatism always, as a political and as a social phenomena, becomes prevalent and widespread and marked when there is a perceived sense of loss. And I think this perceived sense of loss is what has happened in India, which a lot of people did not recognize. You know, for example, when a justice of the Supreme Court starts defining what is Hinduism, there is something wrong. I'm not saying that Hinduism can be defined. I personally am one of those who believes that it's just got too many sets of beliefs, not all of them having a coherent unity. And I don't believe it needs to be. If someone wants to do it as an academic exercise, you're welcome to do it. But politically, you know, sometimes it's more a political category than as a theocratic construct. There is something wrong. Then you feel there is an intrusion. When you see that an RTE, right to education, allows everyone to have institutions but not Hindus as Hindus, then you feel a sense of loss. So it's this sense of loss when you find that certain cherished values are being disregarded. For example, why is there such a revulsion in the social media against some of the English language channels?
Right.
I'm just giving you that as an example. There's a profound revulsion. They love to give gullies to them, and not in parliamentary terms also. It arises from saying, look, you are articulating values which have nothing to do with us. It's not merely that you're just saying something different. I don't think people mind that much. In India, everybody says something different. It's the values. So the question of, now all these things can be accommodated within personal views, it can be social movements, it can be political parties. Now where does it come into the realm of government? I think that's really something, because a government is far more complex. And by and large, the attempt has been to keep social issues out of governance. But in the past 20 years or 30 years, thanks to activists, this is a new class of breed people called activists, which have emerged in India, a lot of legislation has become terribly intrusive, which intrude on people's personal lives and the way they think of it. And there has been a sort of a chaotic but a definite discernible reaction against it. We can't sort of identify and pinpoint and say, this action caused this reaction. It's not like that. But overall, it's this feeling that some of our values are under threat. Now, these don't necessarily always become electoral issues either. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. But it's there in society. And it's by no means confined to the sort of pensionable generation like mine. It is something which I've seen quite widespread even among youth, although their articulation is far more aggressive. In Ayodhya 91, the most aggressive lot were people in jeans and sneakers from Andhra Pradesh. I'm talking as an eyewitness to that whole thing. So you would have thought it would be some Tilakdari Sadhu Baba with a Trishul. No, it wasn't. So I think, but that's really my own personal thing, is that legislate less. We are an over-legislated country. And half the time we say, what is the government doing? The instinctive reaction is a cold wave in Delhi. The TV shows, oh, government kya kar rahe, sarkar kya kar rahe. So that's an instinctive reaction now. It's, yeah.
So just before the next question, actually the entire business of courts defining Hinduism originally began with the debates about temple entry. But I think your broad point is that using the same approach mechanically to a range of socio-economic issues is a problem.
I think I personally am in sympathy with the conclusion of the court.
Right.
But how the courts came to that conclusion is something, you know, the point is, if there is a conflict between custom and the normative aspects of the constitution,
right,
what do you do?
Right.
And that is, to my mind, what would have been the central. It doesn't matter what, right, you don't have to quote 30 verses from the Bhagavad Gita or something
right
else.
I mean, for the younger students, the context is that in the 50s and 60s, when there were temple entry legislations challenged by upper caste groups, many of these upper caste groups were making the argument that they're not Hindus, because they wanted to claim the protections of being minority groups. So it was in that context that the early Supreme Court judgment started defining Hinduism extensively. And Mr. Dasgupta's response is that same conclusion could have been arrived at through a different route as well. Right. Okay, so I think, sir, you wanted to respond? Or?
Why can't set up educational institution? Now it is wrong, because Hindus, wherever they are a minority, they can set up educational institution. They can be linguistic minority also sometimes. Two.
I thought this was a great lecture. You're right. If there is a
between what we call conservative and fundamentalist, because people who are, you know, glorifying past, want to revive Islam or Christianity, whatever, they also come up with similar kind of argument. And the third thing on which I want you to react is, which in my opinion was the most interesting one, that there was a Congress prior to independence which accommodated these majoritarian view. If that was right, and since the questions were raised about the cow slaughter, then Muslim members, almost all of them, in the Constituent Assembly said, made it part of fundamental right. And we did not make it part of fundamental right. But there was no opposition from any minority. In fact, most minorities, even Muslim states, several Muslim princely states, had also prohibited cow slaughter. But we did not make that choice in the Constitution. Similarly, on the whole question of conversion, the word propagation was added in Article 25 on the specific demand of the Christian community to accommodate conversion. So I would like you to, and if this is so, that the Congress today has changed, so can we say that BJP is new Congress, which will accommodate all the views? It will become a Congress of 40s or 30s?
Yeah. Okay. It's an interesting point about whether we can have competitive religious conservatisms within the same thing. There is something called Christian conservatism, which has a great impact in the electoral politics of the United States. But as I told you, conservatism is by definition a national project. It's not a universal project. There are Muslim conservatives and there are Muslim radicals. That's one of the more interesting debates which is going on in the world of Islam today, between the radicals and the conservatives, people who actually adhere to the scriptures and those who also adhere to the scriptures but have a different interpretation of it and want to take it to a certain political turn. That debate is more widespread in Islamic countries rather than in India. Now, in India, the point is that if you ask most of them, people apart from Adityanath and some of them, they will tell you, it's not that we want India as a Hindu state, but India is a Hindu country, by which they mean that most of the defining attributes of India culturally have some basis in what is loosely called Hinduism. Loosely. That is, therefore, they say that, therefore, just as Britain might be wedded to a denominational church, but in reality is as secular as you can get. You have India working in a similar sort of way, that there is inherently something which is Hindu about India, and therefore if you try to deny that and deculturalize India, and that's where the issue of constitutional patriotism comes, you are actually creating a contrived and artificial nation. That is the thing. The question really is, you know, and you're entirely right that at the time of the Constituent Assembly debates, and this is where the aftermath of partition comes out, those Muslims in India were actually more than willing, and this was partly a response to that, that look, we don't want the ignominy of that to be attached to us. That was the feeling. And therefore they sometimes actually went overboard in trying to accommodate. But for various reasons, they decided that not to make laws absolute in this case. And here, as you see in the case of cow slaughter, in the case of cow slaughter and proselytization, there have been lots of state legislation which have been done, and all these state legislations have been done by Congress governments, every one of them. So it was working on two different levels. One is at the level of the nation, at the level of the center, and again at the state. But what it actually meant was that the Congress was, in a sense, trying to accommodate both strands: the aggressively Nehruvian view, and the reviews of the other conservatives, if I can call them that, at the grassroots. And this balance or this arrangement snapped in 1969.
Yeah, I mean, in the literature, we often come across a distinction between no concern secularism and equal respect secularism. And very often there are attempts to understand these events through those two lenses. But I would say that even using that category itself becomes difficult. In fact, if we get the sense of your argument, you're saying that Western style equal respect secularism is also sometimes not, you can't really apply it to the Indian context in the same way. Or the idea of accommodative or equal respect secularism itself is missing certain specificity.
Well, it is equal respect in some way. There's an implicit thing is equal respect. But the way in which society shapes itself is never equal. Because it does follow certain norms. I mean, the ethos, the cultural ethos of some parts of the Northeast is not the same as the cultural ethos which prevails somewhere else. You know, Mizoram, for instance, had a very rigid prohibition policy. I think they just gave it up.
Yeah.
And it was dictated almost entirely by the church. So, but that's part of Indian, the mosaic. It's not threatening your nationhood in any way.
Two questions. The first is, while the roots of conservatism as we commonly understand it came from a situation where there was the nation state and such political models, there is an argument in India which says that India is more of a state nation, in that we are only a overarching political body which accommodates within itself many cultural ethoses, many nations, as it were. How does conservatism address this sort of problematic, this sort of framework? And secondly, and this is more of a general question, in line with what we've just heard about how there was splintering of the Congress, or it went from an inclusive group to where it could be rightly labeled, to the situation that we are in, where honestly it often feels like political parties and political interest groups are talking at cross purposes, not engaging with each other. How does conservatism engage with the lack of engagement by any other party? How do you react to an absence of concrete political engagement when it's reduced to mostly name calling, slurs, and the usual battles that we see on social media? So those two questions.
I think the other way of framing the question is, why is there no modern day equivalent of the Swaraj Party? I mean, since you referred to that.
Swatantra Party,
sorry. Yeah. Sorry.
And if you can add that the first breakup was of these people who basically include us, there was an economic story.
Okay. Now, the first question about what constitutes India? Is there something viable called India? Now, that's a larger debate. Is it a cultural nation? is it a nation built, as some people have very persuasively argued, built on the notion of a sacred geography? You know, because that was what the original linkages were, which cuts across language. It is certainly a departure from the nation state as we know it in the European context. It's undeniable. Therefore, there is a certain measure of Indian exceptionalism, uniqueness, call it whatever you want to, in this. And therefore, and India's conservatism has based itself on the idea that that's where the sacredness issue comes in. You can't cut off one limb and say, you know, that limb is exceptionally sacred, although that's the entire, you know, a lot of the Tirthasans are formed with cutting off of the limbs. So that construct, it has always proceeded on that assumption. We haven't as yet had a Dravidian conservatism. Maybe it's there, I mean, it could come, but so far it's not been the case. Whether it'll come about, and you'll form a bong conservative thing or something, because half the inspiration of the old cold conservatives were bong, Bengali. And the second question was on
more to do with
the process of dialogue. You see, I mean, there has been a feature of conservatism is that it's banked on always what is called the silent majority. This is a term which you'll often find. Of those who are unrepresented or underrepresented in academia, which, like the media, has a left liberal bias. It's well acknowledged, and that's not merely only in India, it's there in various other parts of the world. So it's how common sense overrides the intellectuals. It's a class war in that sense also, sometimes. And it's Donald Trump probably is a very interesting example. His articulation is as crude as you can get, but the impulses which he seeks to articulate, they are legitimate. And if they'd found a little more sophisticated person who could have articulated those same impulses, they could have probably have won the Republican nomination, and who knows, maybe have even... Look at the Brexit issue which is happening in the United Kingdom. The debate again is fascinating, of loss of sovereignty. The entire vocal crowd, the beautiful people, are all saying, oh, we have to stick with the EU. But you go down to the smaller towns, the older people, then you'll get another sense. Maybe it's a harking back to a nostalgia of the time when Britain controlled its own destiny. It's also a sense of loss.
Okay, so in the interest of time, we'll take the last two questions maybe together.
So I recognize that when you say that the Indian conservative is unique in that our understanding of nationalism cannot be divorced from cultural or religious identity. But moving forward, given the fact how conservatives have evolved in other countries, like how issues such as Brexit is framed, for instance, an emphasis is placed on how national identity should, moving forward, be more visceral than our appeal to like cultural or religious identity. So given the fact that our emphasis on constitutional citizenship should be prioritized over our citizenship as like Hindus or Muslims, especially in a multicultural democracy, how do you think the progressive strand within conservatism will resolve or make this choice, if at all you feel like this choice should be made?
Okay, we'll take the last question.
In modern in discussions in the media as well, we see that there's a lot of discussion of the policies and the philosophy of the left. But if you look at the right side of the Indian political scenario, there's no much discussion on what is the philosophy and the policies of the right side of the political spectrum in India is. We discuss about the right. It is always like BJP, how BJP is impulsing its nationalistic policies on the country and its people. But there is no much discourse and discussion on the policies and philosophy of the right. So why do you think this is so in the Indian media discussion itself?
Okay, now I'll keep that as a final comment. But it's in this question of the constitutional citizenship, etc. Now, it's not that these ideas haven't existed in the world of Indian conservatism. If you look at the Swatantra Party is a very interesting case study. Electorally, it got nowhere for two different reasons. One is, it was seen as a party of the Maharajas, the old princely India. And secondly, it had a very intimate connection with Indian industry at a time when business was a dirty word. I'm talking about the 60s. So in one sense, the conservative, the Swatantra Party was ahead of its time. And it carried a lot of baggage, which was thought to be socially burdensome. But the Swatantra Party had two basic currents within it. One was represented by, to some extent, Rajaji, by people like K.M. Munshi, who tried to see conservatism as the Swatantra Party as an agency of freedom, enlarging the scope of freedom outside state controls. And that necessarily also brought in culture. And they had a big thing about the Hindu essence of it. K. Munshi was, after all, the founder of the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, which played a very important role in this respect. And then there was someone like the Masani, Meenu Masani, a Parsi cosmopolitan who came from the left and moved into the Swatantra, who was probably very European in the way he approached politics. So it's, and he had little or no time for anything to do with identities based on religion. I mean, he saw it exactly as you're seeing it. So it's not, the problem is that while it is certainly a worthwhile project to uphold the idea of constitutional citizenship, and to my mind, that's the bare minimum. The question arises, you see it as the be-all and end-all. Or you, I'm assuming you're seeing it as a, I might be misrepresenting you. But to some people, it's just a starting point. That's the starting point. After that, there could be embellishments. And if you have to take citizenship to the popular level, it needs more than the constitution to acquire a sense of belongingness in India. And that's where culture comes in. And with that culture, elements of faith also come in. Because culture and faith cannot be really separated. And to get to that final, and this is a question which has been resonating in different ways all over, on the question of the media. Now, the point which is very, very disturbing today is the remarkable extent to which the 9 o'clock news or television discussions are shaping the intellectual agenda. It's distressing. Because television as a medium is governed by the sense of superficiality. If you want to do well in television, before you go to the studios or before the cameras come to you, think of 2 one-liners, just get them in, and that's it. That's all there is. That's all they have time for. That's how much the attention span of a person is.
Or if you try to explain, they'll interrupt you.
Yeah, exactly. So there's no point trying to do it. So it's based on that. Now that's good fun. And there is a time and occasion for that. But if politics, or at least politics insofar as it concerns thinking people, is going to be reduced to that, and you're going to react only to that, there is something wrong. And alas, today, social media, which began as a way of democratizing the sense of participation of people, to have a larger input into people who make decisions, and at least they'll know this is the broad trend of thinking which is going on. It still gives you a sense of what is playing out and what is not. But it is also following the rules set by the mainstream, some of that electronic media, or maybe, I don't know who started what. But anyway, both are sort of feeding on each other in some way. And it's really the end of discussion. It's the end of any form of intellectualism, right or left, which is taking place. And I hope we grow weary of it. When there is a certain novelty, we were led but the boredom of All India Radio and Doordarshan and very predictable headlines, the Prime Minister said that. So obviously that had to break some way. And it broke. And maybe if I look upon it as terms of certain excesses are happening as a result of that initial exhilaration of freedom. I hope it's that, and not a more permanent state of being.
Okay, I mean, there's a lot more that we could be talking about, but since Mr. Dasgupta has a flight to catch, we'll have to close there. I thank him for taking the time out and coming all the way to Hyderabad just for this talk.
Thank you.
And given that this question of how civic identity interacts with group identity based on religion, ethnicity, culture is a central concern in our curriculum, we hope that you will also visit us in the future if you are able to plan some more detailed engagement, maybe with other panelists in the coming future. So thank you again.
Right.
Gracias.